Welcome to the second module. In this module, we're going to dive into healing nutrition practices that our ancestors understood as so pivotal during the postpartum. Before we jump in, I just want to distinguish the difference between nutrition in the West and nutrition in the East. In the West, we have a more reductionist view of nutrition. So we look at things like calories and nutrients and energy. But in the East, we see things a little bit more holistically. We look at a person as a whole in order to determine what kind of foods that person needs. I think we should also note that Western medicine is based heavily on cadaver studies, so studying a dead body and looking at the different parts. Eastern medicine and nutrition tends to treat a person as more of a whole. So it will look at where that person is in their lives, what kind of energy is important for them, what season they're in, where they live, and all of these factors play a role in determining what will make that person healthiest. Another important component of Eastern medicine is the idea of qi, or life force. Now, in the West, we have this idea of energy, but it's not quite the same as qi. This energy is detectable. It can be measured, something like light or heat. But in the East, we understand that there is energy in everything, and much of that energy is not detectable, even though it's flowing through every part of this universe at every moment. When we give birth, we lose a massive amount of blood and qi. In the West, we don't really think about how to rebuild that blood and qi in any way besides maybe taking a multivitamin. But in the East, we understand that the diet is really the building blocks of our health. What we eat becomes our blood. Our blood becomes our organs. Our organs become our bodies. Our bodies become ourselves. So to heal from pregnancy and childbirth, both mentally and physically, we need to be healing with the right foods. Nutrition for postpartum in the East is all about rebuilding the mother. Soon after giving birth, a woman's hormone balance shifts, she loses a ton of fluid, her body begins to make breast milk, and all of this happens all at once. She needs a diet that's going to help her cope with all of those different experiences. For that reason, people work together to create this healing food for her, to deliver it to her so that she can rest. This way of eating was created solely to help a mother's transition. This is quite the opposite in a typical Western hospital where nobody really thinks or talks about food in relation to healing. After I gave birth, my midwife brought me Jell-O, which, for reasons we're soon going to find out, is pretty much the opposite of any kind of healing diet. A lot of us try to do it all after we give birth. We try to clean and to cook, but so many of us find ourselves feeling really exhausted down the road. In traditional Chinese culture, 30 to 100 days of rest is necessary for a new mom. They understand that without that time, she's more than likely to become exhausted down the road. So how did our ancestors used to do it? If you're taking this course, chances are you have thought a bit about your diet, and maybe you feel tied to a certain kind of way of eating, whether that's vegan or paleo or vegetarian. But I want to note that in almost all ancient cultures, there was a practice of eating animal foods during the postpartum. These foods were thought to be the most nutritionally dense, healing, and blood building, offering the exact kind of energy and nutrients that a depleted mother needs. I know, especially in the vegan community, we have this idea that we can't be love and light if we're ingesting animals, or we take in the trauma that the animal felt when it was killed. On the other hand, traditional spirituality places us on the earth realm. Spirits exist around us, yes, but as we live embodied, we are part of this experience on earth. And what is more constant on earth than the cycle of life and death? To exclude ourselves from this cycle is really a privilege. And a lot of us do have that privilege today. We can shop at supermarkets and farmers markets. We're not dependent on the cycles and the seasons, and we're perfectly capable of eating a vegetarian diet. But I want to encourage you, no matter what your diet is, to be open-minded during this period. As we've talked about before, the veil between worlds is thin during pregnancy and postpartum. This creates a great opportunity to connect with our ancestors, and one great way to connect with them is through the foods that they used to eat. So, more than likely, you come from a culture that did eat animal foods during the postpartum, and that practice might work really well for you during this time as you transition from maiden to mother. Now, if it doesn't work for you, that's fine too. You're perfectly capable of getting all of the nutrients you need on a plant-based diet. Just be aware that it takes longer and it takes a little bit more work to make sure you're truly getting that healing nutrition. I wanted to share traditional recipes with you that would be accessible no matter what your diet is. So all of the recipes in your recipe book are vegan and gluten-free. It's just kind of a way to give you a base. So from there, if you want to supplement with animal foods, it's perfectly fine and easy to do. And if not, that's great too. Just make sure that no matter what you're eating as organically and locally as possible. These foods are going to have the highest nutrient density, which of course we need. If you are consuming animal products, make sure to get the best quality, which means free range, pasture raised, grass fed, if possible, from a farmer's market. I know that it might be more expensive, but if there's ever a time to prioritize healthy, organic food, postpartum is the time. And just in an effort to be totally honest with you guys, I'd love to share with you a little bit about how I ate during this time. I went into my pregnancy as a vegan, and that worked really well for me. I did it mostly because of my relationship with the animals. But soon into my pregnancy, I found that it just wasn't working. I was so depleted, I was so sick, I could barely get out of bed, and I knew that I needed animal food. For a lot of people, they have the complete opposite reaction. They're meat eaters, and going vegan is what saved them. But again, we're dealing with the individual, and we're looking at the individual holistically, and each person in each climate, in each season, might need something different to be healthy. So I made the decision 3 months into my pregnancy to open up my diet and try new foods, and that basically healed me. A few months after giving birth, those cravings just completely went away, and I realized that I had listened to my body, I was done healing with animal foods, and I was ready to go back to the way I ate before. So I just want to encourage you guys to be open-minded when it comes to diet. Because no matter what, if you want to eat a little bit more closely to how your ancestors ate, you're going to be making changes. Let's talk about digestion. If we're not digesting our food properly, then we're not absorbing any of its healing medicine. And a lot of us actually do have some issues with digestion that we might not even be aware of. One way to know if you're not properly digesting your food is to check your stool and see if anything looks undigested. Another way is to check your tongue. If it's scalloped or ridged around the sides or edges, that's another sign that our digestion is not working properly. After we give birth, digestion tends to be weaker. So it's really important to feed our digestion properly. One way to do this that is well known in the traditional Chinese medicine community is to eat warm or cooked foods only. When we're cooking our foods, we're heating them up to a temperature that the body is better able to absorb. Think about it this way. Your stomach, or let's say your body's oven, only cooks food or digests at a certain temperature. So if we're eating cold foods, the body has to work harder to heat those foods in order to digest them. Cooking food also breaks up the cell walls and makes the nutrients more bioavailable. In the same vein, you want to have warm or hot liquids only. These kinds of liquids are going to really move food through your body and help out with slow digestion. Think about it this way. Let's say you wash down a meal with a glass of ice water. That ice is going to act in your body just like it would outside your body, freezing that food and keeping it stuck where it is. So the more we can replenish our lost fluids with hot liquids and teas and at least room temperature water, the more we're going to be moving things along and helping our digestion. Another way to enhance digestion is keeping it simple. So small meals, fewer ingredients, eating them maybe every 2 to 3 hours. Let's not overburden our digestion with big meals with lots of different types of food that all digest at different speeds. We can also look towards warming spices. Warming spices can be super healing and delicious during the postpartum. Not only will they enhance the flavor of your food and make eating a more enjoyable experience, but they'll help with circulation and speed up healing. Cloves, cinnamon, nutmeg, black pepper, these kind of spices are going to be great for you. Ginger especially is an awesome postpartum healing food. Ginger warms and stimulates circulation. It can even help your uterus contract faster to its pre-pregnancy size. Now, if you're not already taking probiotics, you want to start like yesterday. Probiotics are crucial for digestion. They're basically these microscopic living bacteria that exist in billions or even trillions in our bodies. We are made up entirely of bacteria. Giving our bodies these living bacteria through fermented food will enhance your digestion, enhance the nutrient profile of your foods, and even help with cognitive health. A lot of research today is linking brain and gut health. You can even think of your gut as your second brain, as that is where our intuition and our immune system lies. Some ways to get probiotics are through fermented foods like kombucha, kefir, tempeh, miso. There are actually a lot of ways we might not be familiar with, and I'm going to include a list in the recipe book that goes with this module. The traditional Chinese medicine diet looks to Mother Nature for inspiration. These principles came about 4,000 years ago, a time when people were living a lot closer to nature. They depended on the cycles and the seasons to survive and thrive, and they understood that the nature medicine provides in each different time period is the exact same medicine that the body needs. So let's eat seasonally. We can think about it this way. Why do strawberries grow in the summer and foods like squash and garlic grow in the winter? Each of these foods has a very specific energy. So squash and garlic is going to be more warming. And I don't mean warming in the traditional Western sense of how it feels when you touch it, but the energy that it creates in the body when digested. Strawberries, on the other hand, are going to be more cooling. They cool down the body. We are the seasons and we are the elements. Nature exists within us and without us. We are a microcosm of the macrocosm. So eat what's growing around you when you give birth. If you're giving birth in the winter, eat all the squash and garlic. If you're giving birth in the summer and it's warm where you are, you can eat some strawberries, even though they're raw. It's all about connecting to the environment that you're in when you give birth. Chinese medicine also recommends eating foods with collagen for tissue repair. That's why foods like pig's feet, fish, eggs, and bone broth are typical healing foods. But if you're going the plant-based route, then I recommend the wood ear mushroom. This medicinal fungus is known to clean, nourish, and activate blood while increasing body fluids. In addition to its collagen content, it's high in vitamin K, cellulose, and iron, all very valuable in maintaining healthy blood. The doctrine of signatures is the idea that if something looks like it's good for a certain part of the body, it usually is. So, for example, let's look at the walnut. The walnut looks a lot like the brain. In traditional Chinese medicine, everyone understood that walnuts were a brain food. And now it seems like modern science is catching up with this ancient wisdom, understanding that walnuts are high in DHA, which is an omega-3 fatty acid that promotes brain health. In this same way, we can look to foods with this kind of deep red, blood-like color. So foods like cherries, strawberries, and beets, in addition to red meat, if you eat meat, are going to be your greatest blood builders. Blood, of course, in Chinese medicine is not just that red liquid that courses through our veins, but it's seen more holistically as being enlivened with qi, that vital life force. In this way, it's not only the physical body that blood nourishes, but it's also our shen, or our spirit. So when we're blood deficient or qi deficient, we're gonna feel symptoms beyond just anemia. We also might feel diseases of the spirit, like depression or anxiety. In traditional Chinese medicine, postpartum depression and anxiety are viewed as symptoms of qi deficiency. So eating foods that are gonna help you build up your blood and your qi can actually help in more ways than just the physical. Examples of foods that specifically build qi and blood are clean animal protein, lentils, black beans, green leafy vegetables, bone broths and soups, eggs and egg yolks, whole and well-cooked grains, mushrooms, and seaweed. So eat all of these as much as you can. I want to note here that it really takes a village to feed a new mother. So often in our culture, we talk about what a mother should do and how she should behave, how she should take care of her baby, and how she should get him to sleep, and this and that, but so rarely do we talk about what we can do for her. Nourishing a mother during the postpartum is one of our most important jobs as members of her tribe, as her family, as her friends. It takes a lot of effort to put these meals together. What better way can we ask others to help us during this period than by nourishing us, by preparing for us delicious home-cooked foods made with their love and intention? This idea brings the grandmother hypothesis to mind. Unlike most other mammals, humans live well past their childbearing years. The hypothesis is that we need our grandmothers, we need these people in our tribe to help us raise the next generation, that having these people around close to us is crucial to our survival. Now, we might not be lucky enough to have family nearby and we've lost the village, but we can still do a lot to help our new moms out. Mealtrain.com is one resource. You can use that website or you can just gather your family and friends and say, hey, maybe instead of this crib you want to get me, you can cook me some food for the postpartum. And remember, eating with a new set of guidelines can be completely overwhelming, especially in a culture that doesn't typically view food as medicine. So take a deep breath, gather your support, and remember that these are just ideas that are here to help you. Take what you want from them, look back at your own tradition, what your ancestors ate, and have fun with it. You can begin by preparing some of these meals now and keeping them in your freezer for after you give birth. I feel like here the placenta deserves an honorary mention in terms of our postpartum diet. The placenta grows alongside your baby as he grows. It nourishes your baby, it warms him, and it wards off infection. Some cultures believe the placenta is even the tree of life. So, should we eat our placenta? Let's look at the animal kingdom for some inspiration. Most placental mammals do eat their placenta. On the one hand, this might be to hide the evidence of their birth from predators. On the other hand, there might be some biological reasons to do this. Some women claim that eating the placenta helps increase breast milk, hormone regulation, iron levels, and energy. They even might attribute eating the placenta to not having any postpartum depression or anxiety. Other women have the complete opposite reaction. They feel sick, or they feel like it inhibits their breast milk production. It's up to you to decide what you want to do. For me personally, I chose to encapsulate my placenta, and I felt like it gave me a lot of energy. Another question I like to ask is, what did our ancestors do? Did they eat the placenta? Well, it's kind of debatable. In traditional Chinese culture, there is evidence of eating placenta, but it wasn't necessarily eaten by the mothers. It may have been used as a remedy for family of the new mother to help replenish their qi. There's also evidence of other cultures that may have eaten the placenta during times of famine, or fed it to infants, or used it as homeopathic remedies. What is consistent across cultures is that the placenta is treated ceremoniously. It's not just discarded like waste as it is in most hospitals in the United States. One tradition that resonates with me is the Navajo tradition of burying the child's placenta within the sacred four corners of a tribe's reservation as a bind between land and ancestors. I feel this is an example of how powerful ritual and intent can be. Furthermore, the idea of burying the placenta seems like a really great way to give back to the earth. So, we're new moms, we want to be nourished. What better way to open ourselves up to nourishment than by giving nourishment to the earth? If you plan to consume your placenta, then you'll want to have it refrigerated immediately after birth. If you're going to be cooking it or dehydrating it in the next day, it's fine to leave it in the refrigerator. If you're going to take any longer than that, then put it in the freezer until you're ready. It should be treated like any other organ meat. Make sure that the hospital, if you're giving birth in a hospital, knows that you want to save your placenta. Otherwise, the go-to is sadly to throw it away. If you're planning to encapsulate your placenta, then you have to decide if you want to have it steamed or raw. And if you don't want to eat or bury your placenta, there are other options. You can always make it into jewelry or have it printed or whatever else people are doing these days on the internet. Just do a quick search and I'm sure you'll find something that sounds great to you.